So before we took a break, we were talking about submission of test data that's over and above what is currently required as part of our testing regulations. And Chris Urmson from Google, you had a scenario or a suggestion about what type of test data could be provided. So I wanted to see if you could elaborate more about that.
Chris Urmson from Google. Sorry. So what I was trying to talk about earlier was the kind of the disengaged data that the DMV is requiring we submit as part of the testing regulations that are in place right now. And so when we operate our vehicles for testing on the roads, we give our test drivers very clear kind of rules of engagement that describe that they disengage preemptively before the vehicle really gets into any particularly exciting situations. And what this means is that, and that's disengaging for safety reasons, right? That we want them to be safe out on the road. So we have a lot of those as we're testing the vehicles because we're incredibly cautious when we're out on the roads. It's in our interest and in the public interest. But what we do with that data is when we bring it back to our data centers to use it to develop the software, is we can actually simulate forward what the vehicle would have done in any given scenario and look at, compare that to how the driver performed and how the vehicle deviated from that. And would there be any kind of incident that would come from that, whether it would be, accident or some other weird, failure mode. And so we actually tag those scenarios where in simulation the vehicle would have done something kind of untoward, and we classify those as what we call internally a critical disengage. And those are ones where we pay particular extra attention from and then we feed those into the test sets that the vehicles execute before we're going out back on the road. And so across that and all the other testing, we basically anytime an engineer makes a change in our code base, we're rerunning those scenarios, evaluating the improvement against them. And sometimes these things are challenging to fix. And so that becomes part of the rules engagement is, don't have the vehicle operate near whatever the environment is that generate that. Other times we're able to remedy that, add that to the test database, and continue with the testing as normal.
Okay, so. Thanks.
Thanks.
Oh, hi, Kaushik Raghu from Audi, Volkswagen Group of America. So we test these cars on California public roads as well, and I'd like to echo Chris's opinions. So when my drivers, my team is out testing, we avoid situations that the car is not designed to operate in. So as in essence, we don't get the kind of data that you may think is of value to your process of the disengagement report. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure, so we have our own process where independent of testing on public roads in California, we test all around the country, we test in Europe, in private tracks, we have test tracks where we do these tests, where we learn a lot more about some of these more critical situations. But other than that, when we put these cars on public roads, just like Chris said, we are very careful about what we do. And we don't see ourselves often try to get into situations where these types of events happen or we get reports that is of use to us.
Kaushik, just to follow up on that, and when we were talking about earlier about the certifications and the different types of capacities of vehicles, knowing that vehicles are going to be designed to operate in certain conditions and things like that, should we in the regulations look to, and I think I raised this earlier, that there is some certification, some assurance, something to us that says that the vehicle can't engage in the situations that you haven't designed it to. So for example, if you've designed a vehicle that the only time it could be autonomous is on a highway, on a freeway, would we look to something that some assurance from you that you can't activate it in autonomous mode in a setting that it's not designed to go?
I honestly don't know the answer to this question.
Okay, I put you on the spot, I'm sorry. Yeah, Chris, go ahead.
Chris Urmson with Google. So I think, we talked a little bit about weather, and there's a lot made of that some of these technologies can't operate in all weather conditions. That limitation really comes back to that functional safety analysis that we were talking about earlier, right? That is a failure mode of the vehicle, And that in designing the vehicle and in the safety process you're executing to get to that design, you know, you take that into account and you account for, you know, you accommodate that limitation. So I think it's part of doing your diligence in designing an effective system, safe system.
Thank you. Is there anyone else like to speak on that? Okay. It's 1 o'clock, and I know we had the hearing set to go until, I shouldn't call it a hearing, it's our workshop, to 2. And the last subject, and we had briefly touched on it before we took the break, was the use of test data, and that's what we've been talking about here. The use of test data to inform the regulatory process, the use of test data to validate the certifications made by manufacturers, and you know, if is in accepting test data, is that something that gets us more comfortable with a mode of things like relying on the functional looking at functional safety and saying, okay, they did the test data, they validated the assumptions that they've been making, we don't need to go any further. So, you know, what I'm opening up here is the acceptance and use of test data something that would substitute the concerns about having to rely on some third party to do the certifications. But also with that, again, we have the practical limitations of who is reviewing the applications, and that's us here at DMV. And so in the acceptance, if we went to a mode where we are accepting test data, do we actually have the expertise to even know what we're looking at? And so I'd like to open up that discussion. Can we rely on test data? And if so, who would be the people that would give us the assurances that the test data is something that's reliable? Anyone? Right ahead.
Thanks. Really just to reiterate the point that I made earlier, test data is not sufficient to test a hard, real-time, artificially intelligent or expert system. You simply cannot rely on that to cover the entire universe of what kinds of failure modes there might be. And in terms of the expertise and the need to have details of the test data that then might compromise OEM's IP, that really does argue for a third party.
Okay, thank you. You know, okay, I'm not going to let you guys get out of the room without spending at least a little bit of this next hour that we have on the schedule. So since I got guards at the back doors, they're going to hold them closed. Now that you're here, and you know what the task is that we have to do in coming up with the regulations, we've followed an agenda this morning. We've heard various comments. I'd like to open it up for a discussion of any other things that you think that we need to consider, any advice that you have for us, any suggestions that you would like to make to us. I'd also like to point out that this doesn't have to be the end, over the past 2 years, many of you manufacturers know we've come and we've visited with you. We've had you here to the department. We are thirsty for knowledge about the system. We know that people's comfort levels in speaking to us, and so we would encourage you throughout this process. Since we are still developing the regulations, we are always open to discussions with anyone on the subject matter. And so we would encourage you, as I mentioned on the agenda, there is a listing of what our mailbox is specifically for these regulations. You can always send something to that mailbox there if you want to submit something written to us. I don't even care if you put your name on it. You know, if you want to give us some suggestions and some ideas, you know, my dad used to say there's no bad ideas. Yeah, I had a lot of them. But at this point, we're in that hunt for how do we come up with some regulations. And I know that everyone is not necessarily willing to speak here in an open forum like this, and so we would encourage you to continue to participate in the process. You can get in contact with us at any point in time. We will not travel out of state. But we're more than willing to continue meeting with any interested party to talk about how we should go about this process, and really want to encourage you to participate in that. So again, like I said, I want to open it up now for people that might have something that we maybe didn't touch on today that you think would be relevant to us. And I see we already have one person taking me up on that, so please go right ahead.
Hi, Kara Bush with Tech America. We were supportive of the original legislation that was introduced in 2012, and we've been monitoring the regulations over the past 18 months or so, and I think we've heard some great discussion here today on how the department may move forward and some of the challenges that you face. And I'd just like to make a comment that in doing so, we would just ask in drafting the operational regulations that they are non-prescriptive and performance-based, which allow for the flexibility to adapt to the future of the technology. Thank you.
All right. And we hear you, because we know that what, you know, just like I made the joke about my iPhone, just because you put it out today doesn't necessarily mean what you have set yourself in stone for. And of course, we are, our additional concerns with that is how well, you know, like the first adopters, you know, how will they be co-opted into as the technology gets more refined and gets more developed? So this gentleman right up here in the front.
Thank you. Hi, Justin Silva. I work for a software company in the Bay Area. And I just wanted to touch back about a comment that you made about testing and third-party testing companies. And I'm really impartial to what's decided here. You guys know more about this than I do. But I just wanted to kind of mention an experience that I had in that if you require autonomous vehicles to have third-party testing companies, you know, hold any kind of liability for the safety of the vehicles, then it's going to increase the cost of that vehicle from the consumer, like, exponentially. The analogy that I can make is with airplanes. So if you've ever tried to buy an airplane, the cost of the airplane is actually not even, it's like, you know, half of the cost of the airplane is the actual part of the airplane. The other half is just a third-party company that, like what we're talking about here, holds a liability to say these systems will, you know, function, and stands in the way of saying if it fails, it's on us and not on, you know, the manufacturer of the airplane. So if you try to make a third-party company hold any liability for this, you may be looking into something like that, which could impact GM and other of these big car companies from bringing these cars to market and making them affordable for most people. That's it.
Thank you. Okay.
Thanks. Two things. One, to clarify, I don't think that third-party certification companies should be liable any more than Underwriters Laboratory, UL, is liable if, you know, my plug-in heater, you know, burns up or something. I think that the OEMs, the manufacturers, are the ones who should be, you know, should have liability. I had a separate point, which is a question. We've assumed that the rollout of these vehicles would be to the general public, that once the regs are, you know, and published and some kind of certification, whatever it is, that anyone could buy one of these cars. And maybe you're cabined in and that's the only way it can work. But I'm wondering if there might be a tiered approach where the first go-round is that these vehicles could only be owned by fleet operators, whether it would be, you know, Avis, whether it would be taxi companies going autonomous, whether it would be Uber buying cars. It seems to me that, you know, and making them available, cars as a autonomous cars as a service to the public, so that, you know, I can tap on an app and the car comes and picks me up, takes me where I'm going, but I don't own the car. It seems to me that there are controls that fleet owners have and incentives that fleet owners have with regard to interacting with OEMs, with regard to maintenance of the vehicles, with regard to a more structured ability to communicate with DMV and or third-party certification companies that might argue in favor of not just letting 1,000, you know, flowers bloom and letting the public, you know, buy them in the first go-round, but letting the public experience these vehicles and letting the DMV and the system experience these vehicles first in a fleet cars as a service context. And again, I don't know if the statute leaves you that option.
That's the magic question with that proposal is, do we have the authority to do that under the statute? So,
and perhaps one way of exercising authority of that sort would be to require different levels of certification and or testing, depending on whether the vehicles are operated in a fleet context or not, so that you incentivize the commercial market to first deploy these in a fleet kind of way, even though you're not literally prohibiting them. And that might give you the opportunity to phase things in.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Christopher Nowakowski with UC Berkeley. We've talked a whole lot about the role of third parties, and I just wanted to say from my notes, I've counted at least four ways we've talked about a third party. One, they could be doing a drive test. They could be doing some sort of crash analysis. They could be looking at the test data in place of the DMV. They could be doing some sort of detailed design analysis. And I want to throw out, is there another option on that spectrum where the third party could be just looking at sort of the 50,000 foot overview of what the company's doing in terms of functional safety? Is there value in a third party perhaps looking at what is the company doing, what is their process for doing functional safety? Is that sufficient? And also, what is their process for deciding what's safe or when it's time that they can go to market? Since clearly everyone said that these are things that might be company-based and might not actually follow, say, ISO 262. They might have a similar process. So is there something that's less intrusive than the detailed design analysis that could be the role of a third party?
Any comments on that?
My questions are pertaining to the previous comments. I know the state of Michigan, through the Autonomous Vehicle Symposium that I'm attending in Canada, is actually proposing to have mature drivers enroll in the program first. I don't know if the state of California can look into that as a statute. So somebody who's got 4 years, possibly 10 years of driving experience should roll out with the autonomous vehicles first. And two, the point about testing and self-certification, infant or new technologies as they're rolled out, you know, similar to big screen TVs, cost a lot more. I mean, as technology matures, the price comes down. And, you know, if somebody wants the affordability or wants the technology, they should be able to afford that technology. So I think pricing should not be an issue. It certainly should be offset by the customer, at least in the initial stages.
Now we've come to that quiet time.
Chen
right here. Ready?
Chen Liu with Venable. Brian, I think one of the points that you made earlier was everything that's submitted to the DMV is a public record. And to the extent that you guys can seek authority to be able to protect confidential business information, I think is definitely going to be beneficial for you in the long term. Because what you're evolving from right now is a driver licensing entity organization as your operational requirements into, you know, a pseudo-regulator of the manufacturers. And that role does require you to be able to protect proprietary business information from those OEMs.
There are processes. I mean, you know, there are exceptions under the Public Records Act for protecting confidential and trade secret information, but it's a link. There is a legal process that has to go through. A manufacturer would have to assert the privilege under the evidence code, and that's an exception under the Public Records Act. But it also it almost winds up at the manufacturer would have to initiate a legal proceeding against us to prevent us from disclosing something. But I mean, there are some securities built into the law, and as regulatory agencies, we hit it all the time. So there are some protections that can be had there. Anyone else? Well, now it's, oh, I'm great. Excellent, right here, two, go right ahead.
Okay, Dan Reuter, Electric Movement. I know we're talking about cars here, but I just want to state for the record, I don't think 10-year-olds should be able to get in a car and take themselves wherever they want, whenever they want to. I still think driving and mobility is a rite of passage of growing up, and I don't think that should disappear just because of this technology. That's all.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Dan Mitchell with the City of Los Angeles Department of Transportation. So I came today because the City of Los Angeles is very interested in welcoming this new technology and autonomous vehicles and preparing for them. But in the discussion about test data and also crash data, one thing that occurred to me is as this testing continues and becomes more prevalent, and as we're preparing for the autonomous vehicles to come into public use, it may be beneficial for the DMV to partner with the CHP and include on the standard crash reporting form a little checkbox of whether an autonomous vehicle was involved. So that's something that's not OIM specific, but something that would allow folks to analyze crash data over time about how the autonomous vehicles compare with the general public, general driving public.
We have in our testing regulation there is a reporting requirement for the manufacturers to submit to us when the vehicle has been involved in an accident. And we also, in that reporting, they're reporting to us any accident the vehicle's involved in. And so that can include when someone's not paying attention and rear ends the autonomous vehicle. And so they're actually telling us whether it was an accident that was caused when it was in autonomous mode, so that we would be concerned about is there a problem with the technology, or whether it was an accident that was caused by some other factor unrelated to that. And candidly, so far, we haven't seen anything that has anything to do with the autonomous technology being involved in an accident. I think we've only had
one
report, and it was the other guy's fault. so we are actually in the testing regime. We are actually receiving that kind of data so that we can make that comparison. But we really appreciate your coming today, and maybe you can talk to us at the end of the hearing.
Okay.
Thank you. Rosemary?
I'd like to second that suggestion because it's like trust but verify, you know, to have the CHP checking that off if that's appropriate, and it seems like that would be a good idea.
Well, thank you. Okay, so I don't see any other hands, so I'm going to give you my closing speech. Our next steps, I've said it twice before, but I really want to encourage you to keep involved in this process. If you have suggestions for us that you would like to make, if you would like to submit written comments about the proceeding today, we are more than willing to accept them. You can use the email address that's on the bottom of the outline. Some of you already have our business cards and know how to reach us individually. You can do that as well. We are always open for further discussions with you, whether in a group or individually. We're thirsty for knowledge. Our real goal is to come up with a workable set of regulations, and I think an important part, you all play an important part of us doing that. Once we come up with a draft of the regulations, what will happen is we will do a 45-day notice of that. What that means is that we will start a written comment period that will last for 45 days. What we've done in the past is after that written comment period closes, we will then hold another public hearing where we will accept testimonial type of comments. That's not an adversarial proceeding, and so we would invite people to come in and participate in that. So that what we try to do with the public hearing, as I said, we hold it after the close of the comment period. We like to do it on like Tuesdays. And the reason why we do Tuesdays is because we don't want anybody to have to travel on Sunday night to come to one of our hearings. And so if you're wondering why does DMV always hold their hearings on Tuesdays, it's so that you could travel on work time. So you could look forward to that. When you ask what's the time frame, I don't specifically have a time frame for that, because you have to imagine that we need to look at all of the input that we got here today and then actually come up with a regulatory proposal. And so that may take some time. So when there is no magic day that we're shooting for at some point in the next few months that we would be introducing a regulation. But again, because you have signed in here today or at one of our prior proceedings, you will receive that notice when we have that product. The steps after that, of course, is we take all of the comments, we make a determination whether we need to modify that proposal. If there would be a modification of it, we would again have an opportunity for you to participate in that. That is a shorter period. It would be a 15-day notice. After we do all that, we package it up. We have to summarize and respond to all of the comments that we've received, and then we ship it off to the Office of Administrative Law for review and approval. And of course, they look at their regulatory standards for approval. They take a 45-day period to do that. Once we get that approval, That means that the regulations have now been authorized to go into effect under our enabling statute, Vehicle Code Section 38750. Once we get that approval, they do not become effective for an additional 120-day period. That's just the way the statute is written. So, again, I'll leave you with, please continue to correspond with us. Continue to please talk to us, because your input is probably one of the most valuable assets that we have in this process of trying to tackle these regulations. So I want to thank you all for coming out today. Sorry I didn't give you a lunch break, but I did get you out of here early. Thank you.